Welcome to the webinar for DocuPerformer, how we can support your change requests and projects. Before we go actually into details, let's have a look where we go through. So today, first of all, let me introduce myself. So I'm Remigius Felsner. I'm the business unit manager for the DocuPerformer, and I'm happy to guide you through today through the meeting. First of all, we will have a short overview of our solutions. This will give you some insights on how the solutions fit together, what products we do offer, which components from SAP are supported, and also which modules are available from the DocuPerformer. After this, we will start to have a look into the actual lifecycle of projects and also see in which phases the DocuPerformer can support you respectively. Let's start. Before we actually go into the details, let's have a short overview how the solution fits into the landscape of Bluetelligence. So we do offer mainly two products. The first one is the DocuPerformer, which is meant mainly for developers, BW developers, BPC developers, all developers that work with business analytics suites. We also do have another product that is called Enterprise Glossary, which is meant more for business and has a slightly different approach. And of course, as the target group is also different. So just one, two words about the Enterprise Glossary, just that you get an idea. So the Enterprise Glossary is a web-based platform in contrast to the DocuPerformer, and it is providing key figures and report definitions, which are technology agnostic. So you can basically create fact sheets and templates for elements that are, for example, in ClickView available, that are in BI, Power BI, or not SAP reports. We do also provide a connection to SAP, but again, this is more on a higher level, and you have the possibility to maintain all the aspects that are relevant for you. So all the fields that you can see here, you can basically define yourself, and with this define what information is displayed to the end users. Of course, you have all the compatible functions as searching and accessing via direct URL. Even an integration to Active Directory is possible. And the visual appearance is, as of course said in the beginning, more for business users. So this is one of the products, but now let's have a look to the DocuPerformer, how the DocuPerformer fits into this complete picture. So we do support all different SAP components. So for example, BW, BO, HANA, and BPC. So all components are supported with the respective objects. We will see later what we can do with those objects, but just to understand that you can work basically with all objects. Good. Then let's cover the modules. So each of the objects that we saw can basically be treated with different functionalities. So we do have, of course, the main functionalities, which are documentation and commenting. So here, the main idea is that you can generate from the technical information within the system, you can automatically generate documents and documentation. So you don't have anymore to say and describe how a cube is composed, or which cubes are, how the transformations look like, what the process chains contain, and so on. In addition to this technical information, you can add information that is relevant to you or your project. And here you can, for example, add information for the end users, for the business users. You can describe what you can see within the respective report, within the respective query. You can describe what kind of data is contained in the HCPR, and so on. You can also provide additional information about decisions, why you, for example, implemented it the way it is, or additional information, for example, for auditors, or for any other purpose, as for example, data protection laws, that would help you to better understand what the object is used for, and later on also what you can do with the object or what you have to consider if you want to adjust this. Then for us, especially for the projects and change requests, a very important module is the analysis module. Here we do have plenty functions to basically support you in everyday activities. We will have a look and show in detail what we can actually do with individual functions. Then also for projects that are maybe related to the BW4 migration or the preparation of those, we can also support you in, we call it modeling. At the end, it is the creation, the automatic creation of objects derived from other source systems. So you can, for example, import a multi-provider, you can adjust the naming conventions, convert the respective DSOs into ADSOs, adjust also their naming conventions, and then export those elements to the new system or even also to the same system if necessary. At the end, you can also copy even the queries. And of course, this saves quite a lot of time as you have lower testing requirements and can also save effort instead of by creating basically 6,000 info objects, for example, automatically rather than manually. The last two modules are data lineage. So this is also an interesting module to, if you need to understand how the mappings and transformations throughout your system are conducted. Here you can, for example, select an HCPR. We will also see an example later and understand what transformations are there, what are the different levels of mappings, what are the source fields. And this gives, of course, a good overview and understanding on what is happening with the data on the respective flow. The last module that we do support is the translations module. So here, specifically for the BW objects, we have the possibility to use a dictionary-based approach to translate the BW objects. So every object that you have already translated will be recorded in the dictionary. And then when you, of course, have a similar query with, for example, the same name for the row or the column, it will automatically suggest a translation for you. And you don't have to put it in manually anymore and just have, you can accept it. Of course, you can still override. And we do also provide additional functionality in terms of dependency analysis there to, for example, translate the respective objects that belong to one group, for example, one query, etc. So these are the modules as the overview, but now let's have a look to the actual support for change requests and projects. So before we go into the details, let's have a look and understanding of the project and change request lifecycle. So usually, even though you might do it in different approaches in terms of agile or waterfall, you have certain phases that you have to run through. So for example, analysis phase, where you need to understand what's going on, how much effort do I have, what needs to be changed, do I break something if I adjust this, do I need to follow up on other elements that are impacted by this change. You have then, of course, the design. Then when you understand how it is done, you have to write it down. Then, of course, a big part is the implementation. You need to actually implement the object, and then you test this. Might it be a system integration test or a user acceptance test to then check if all those implemented objects are correctly done. And then, of course, you have to deploy the elements and then go into the support cycle where you need, again, to maybe deal with user problems, tickets, where things come up. And there as well, of course, to understand how things are implemented again. Maybe this is also done by a different team. So all those aspects need to be considered. So if we now map this against the Doku Performer, there are certain phases that are better supported at the moment. So big support is possible throughout the analysis. And again, we will have a look to the respective functions in a minute, as well as the build, the test, and the support as yeah, also within the support, you need to understand what's going on and how things are used and follow the data, etc. So again, the percentage values, you know, they are just indications. At the end, of course, it does depend on how well and how good you adjust your own processes to use the Doku Performer at respective phases, so that you can leverage more of the savings or less. Good. So then let's jump to the actual tool. So this is just the standard view that you get when you basically start working with the tool. So you have the different tabs at the top here, which do basically relate to the different modules that we support. So documentation, commenting, analysis, modeling. And you have on the left-hand side, the respective entity grid where you can select from the objects that are synchronized with your system. So here, for example, I have now selected a multi-provider and I can have a look to the commenting that was done on this object. I can understand what the object is used for. I can also select other objects and have basically different entity types included in one view. Here I have now included as well the queries. And here, so it's easy, of course, to understand what the objects are used for. So the objective here, for example, for this query, I can read it up, I can understand it. I have maybe business aspects. So those chapters are at the end, of course, put into a documentation. So the holistic documentation that can be generated out of this, and for this, let me just show it how quickly this can be done. So I will generate a documentation here for the respective query. I will also include the comments. I will include all comments. So I have the possibility to adjust what kind of file is generated at the end. So I will do that now and will create a file. So now the system will be triggered, will be queried, and the information will be real-time retrieved from the system to generate the document, incorporate the relevant objectives, and then show the result. So the object, the document is opening now. Just 1 second. So here we see the respective result. So all those elements are generated automatically. You don't have to adjust anything anymore. So you can see, for example, the index, which gives you an easy way to navigate. And it gives you all the details, of course, about the other elements. So, for example, here, the respective objectives that we have also seen in the overview. But it also does include, of course, all the other aspects, as, for example, details about the query properties, which you can also turn off if this is too much details. For example, the variables used. Again, also here, the details can be easily adjusted to your target group that is relevant for you. You can see how the different calculations are done, and so on. So this is one example, but again, this is not everything. What you can also do is you can go one step further. You can actually combine several elements of those into one holistic project documentation. So this is, for example, one document that was also automatically, fully automatically generated to contain elements that are, of course, from different systems, maybe even. I could also include HANA elements in here. I could include BO elements and can have one comprehensive, for example, application or project documentation of what was implemented and how it was used. You can see there are even pictures, so you can use all the functionality that is also usually available, of course, in the other word or tools that you are used to work with. So this is one example, of course, about the documentation. And I mean, why do we talk about the documentation? So many aspects, especially when you work through the system and try to understand the changes and go through the adjustments, you need to basically understand how and what needs to be implemented. And just to refer to our best practice article in here, you can see that the change request and projects, how it is supported, right? So usually you have several challenges that you need to deal with. And so, for example, I mentioned a few. So you have to estimate, for example, the change request. You have to understand the dependencies. You have to understand the query definitions if there is something similar, for example. You have to work maybe even with external suppliers to also keep the naming conventions, to understand what was implemented by them, to have the handover to your support team, to bug fix, and so on. So why is then, of course, the documentation important? Of course, it is important because this is the only way to understand why things have been done as they were done. So the technical aspects, of course, we can provide, we can automatically generate. But the comments that you have seen within the respective entities, within the respective objects, as for example, here, some details about the query, those elements need to be preserved for future use. You have to be able to refer back to them. So if you ever have to adjust a query that you can understand, more easily understand, what you need to consider adjusting those elements. And it doesn't necessarily have to be in such a detail as this is now here with, you know, a lot of information. Even some information is usually much better than not having any information at all. So these are the aspects of the, let's say, documentation and the easy generation. If you have also, if you're interested to learn more about the touched scenarios and how you can create comprehensive documentation, we do have also additional YouTube videos and webinars that were already recorded regarding this. There's also a best practice, tips and tricks how to use the scenarios best. So I'm recommending them to you to basically have a look there and to, go into details on how to utilize this fully to your needs. So now coming back again to the other aspects, what we need to do. And again, many of those aspects are regarding the analysis within the project to understand what's going on and what you have within your system, even if you don't have any documentation available or it's only rudimentary or maybe even not up to date. So usually this starts with the understanding of what is in the system, right? And as BW systems are mostly about data transfers and data manipulation and transformations, you need to, of course, understand the flows. So what you can do is you can easily create a data flow of respective objects, reporting objects. So if I would now press here data flow, I've just prepared it to just save time, you would just get this standard view. And the standard view gives you already a good understanding what data and where it is coming from, how complex the data flow is, and so on. This is still similar to what you know also from SAP, but it does have already some additional information. So for example, you can see that there are comments, which would be also possible to access from here. So I can, for example, to better understand how the object is used, I can call the respective comment also from here and just go through it and understand more easily how the things are used, what kind of data is contained, maybe also what is in this transformation, etc. I do also see already that there is some additional processing happening, for example, here in the start routine, but at the moment I don't see any details. But what I can do now is I can also add information. So for example, I can do an ABAP lookup scan to understand what is happening in terms of ABAP routines or AMDP routines within those start routines, end routines, or export routines. I can also add the filters and DTP selections to understand how the data is processed within the flows. I can understand if there are selections within the flow to restrict, for example, regarding certain characteristics. And if I do those two steps, I get a much more detailed view. So here again, Just let me zoom out. This is the same view as we had also before with the added information. So let's have a look what kind of information is now included. For this, I will just zoom in a little bit. So here, for example, we can see now that the start routine does have a lookup. So it is doing additional processing here on this table from this ADSO. We do see that there is additional function modules. We can even see how the process chains and selections, as said, are handled. So here, for example, we do have a loading with three parallel processes with this object class, and we see in which process chains those elements are used. So if we continue, here we see, for example, as well, a selection on a lookup on another ADSO. Here, for example, we do see one of those mentioned filters. So we understand that not all data is processed here on this flow, but we can easily spot what data is processed. So for example, if the client is wondering why he doesn't see plant 3000 data on the multi-provider, you wouldn't be able to understand, hey, here is a filter on plant 1000 to 2000, and therefore plant 3000 cannot be processed. You can also include the objects that are even above the respective multi-provider. So here, if I also show the respective queries, this would be this transaction, I can understand what additional elements are here. So for example, here I see that there is a query built on top of the multi-provider. Again, it could be also HCPR. And I do see also the depending objects. I see, for example, that this element is also used in an AFO report and maybe in a web template. And again, this also helps me to judge upon a change request of project what kind of complexities and dependencies I need to consider. If we have now a look to this multi-provider, we can even also go one step deeper. So as well for the analysis phase, as well as for the testing or support phase, questions arise as, for example, in this report, the data is wrong. Why is, for example, calendar day? This seems to be off. I don't understand how the data is derived within this report for calendar day. So how would you answer the questions usually? You would go into the SAP system, you would start to go through the respective transformations and try to identify all the process steps that have been included in the transformations and so on. We can do it in a different way. We can here in the Doku Performer, we can change to the tree view and we can load, I did that already here, we can load every info object that is used within the multi-provider, we can load and show the respective mapping. And this was done here. So I have done a so-called info object mapping analysis and now see throughout the data flow what kind of processing takes place on the respective levels. This helps me to easily identify how the data is processed within this flow. It helps me to understand where to look. So if there's no mapping at all, it might not be relevant for me. I don't have to look there because nothing is mapped for this info object. I can even jump into the ABAP elements and have a look what's in detail going on there. So this basic view gives me the chance to also go into more details and understand how the calendar date, for example, is returned here. And yeah, how it is processed at the end. So here it will then be returned, for example. Good. So this is one example on how to understand what's kind of going on with the data flows. But again, there are also much more helpful functions. So one of the also very big and useful functions is the where used analysis. So again, the example, if I want to understand where the calendar day is, for example, used, I can basically conduct a where used analysis for this. And here I see the respective result sheet. So here, I mean, the first part are the standard elements. I mean, I can filter for those if I want to. For every column, I can see already many details. This is, of course, similar to what you can see partly also in BW, but this function goes also much further. It gives you also the chance to even find the elements or the areas in the coding where the calendar day is used. So here, for example, you see that it is also used in transformations or maybe even in other reports or includes. And yeah, therefore you can easily understand if maybe if you adjust the calendar day as an info object, what kind of impact it would have on your system. And you don't have to, let's say, go through each transformation manually and try to find the respective places, what's going on. You can, of course, the search as such can be very much tailored. So depending on what you actually want to find, you can select respective elements. So I just show you once what kind of selection options you have. They might be different per selected entity type. So for calendar day or for info object, it might look slightly different than, for example, for the multi-provider that I have selected now here. Even Fox formulas and planning functions are supported. That's also important to mention, as yeah, they are also usually, they could be impacted by the changes. So now you have already some kind of understanding about the system. You know how the data flow is done. You understand if maybe there are other dependencies to other elements, but you can also, let's say, for example, look for certain elements in ABAP directly. So here, for example, after at the end of the project, you might want to check if you still have breakpoints somewhere included after the change request. Maybe somebody did some debugging and tests and forgot to remove the breakpoints. I mean, in production, this might lead at the end to an overflow of the syslog, right? Because usually the system, the production system, cannot go into debugging or at least not stop for the breakpoint. It would just trigger a message, and the message would then be written to the syslog, which then again might lead to filling up the data space. You can also look, for example, for inefficient programmings, right? Select single. Or you can also do other things, as for example, searching for a hard-coded element in your developments. So for example, maybe you use the year 2018 somewhere and you need to adjust this for a change request, year-end changes, organizational changes. Maybe you have to look for a certain company that was selected somewhere, a certain cost element, a certain selection or processing or an interest rate that changed and is used somewhere in the ABAPs. You can look for all those elements and scan throughout the system if it is used somewhere and helps you to identify the places what you need to change. You can also do the same for the queries. So this is also usually not possible within SAP. When you, for example, need to understand where, again, a certain cost element in the selection directly in the ABAP report, in queries was done, you can do that easily with our functions here. So with the scan for value restrictions, here, for example, I have selected the country and I have looked for the selections for Germany, for DE, and can easily identify all the different selections that are done somewhere. So for example, here are the selections in this queries and so on. And so I can easily change those elements, for example, now to a different country, a different cost element, a different account, etc. What else can happen? Imagine you need to change, you have key figures and you need to change those in the reporting and you want to understand if there are actually different definitions within the respective reporting environment. So what you can also do is you can run, for example, for the multi-provider or again for any of those other info providers, you can run an analysis on what kind of key figure definitions you have. And for example, you might want to understand, okay, is open quantity, just as an example, always defined the same way? So you can look through the descriptions and you see that on the multi-provider, there's a key figure, of course, defined for that. And within the queries, you also have the respective usages. So here you see, for example, in the query, you have the same selections. But you also see that, for example, in another query, there's actually an additional selection that has a restricted key figure, but is showing the same description, which could be an issue, right? Why would you have a different definition for those elements? Wouldn't it make sense to keep it consistent and to have the same selection also in there? Before you also start working on the system and also on a change request, maybe you are not completely sure if the elements are still up to date, if they have been changed in the meantime, or if maybe in the production system there was an emergency change that was not transported back, or the change was not also executed and done in the previous system. So you can go here and run for all those elements that you see here in the top, compare two systems. So for example, development and production. And it will show you all the elements that are in one or the other or in both systems. And for the both systems, you can even go one step further. You can highlight all the differences. You can also make the correcting the same values green. I just leave that out now. And if you execute this, it will give you immediately a view if something was changed or not. So in some cases, you might not want to have the last changed by also highlighted. I will just turn that off. And then I can even say here, show only highlighted results. And it will give me immediately all the results where something is different compared for the two systems compared. So here, for example, I see that both systems have a query that does have the same technical name, but it does have actually a different UID, which should not be the case. That usually means that the transport request of a deletion of these elements or this query was not transported. And therefore, you have maybe in the target systems, you might even have two different elements that have the same technical name, but different UIDs. I can even now go also even more into details. I can have a look to compare the actual elements. So I will do this now to understand, for example, okay, what kind of difference is actually in those two elements? Do I have something that I need to adjust? Can I just start developing? Or is there maybe a change that I have to consider and to clarify with the business department or transport something back? Otherwise, I might run into the risk that I transport something that was already fixed, and basically I transport the same problem again to the respective target system. I can then highlight all the differences. I can expand this. I can also apply parallel scrolling so that when I scroll through, I can easily see the differences. And here, for example, I can already see that the namings of those two variables is different. Here it says last date of loading info provider one, and here it says without the one. I can also see that maybe here is an additional variable included that I don't have here in the production system. Maybe in the production system, somebody added an attribute, which is also not included in the development system. And all those elements I can identify, understand, and think about the implications and consider them before spending and wasting effort later on by overwriting something that should have not been done. Another use case that you have usually during analysis is also, what kind of elements, for example, queries, should I use? Can I use, you know, are they used somewhere else, the variables? Should I use the same one? Are they maybe duplicates? How can I adjust them? So all those informations you can derive from the variable analyzer. Here you can easily select one info object or also several info objects. with a star and run through a usage analysis. And here I did that already, and you can see that, for example, how often these queries are used. So you see that zero plant date is, for example, never used, not once. You can also see that other queries are maybe other variables are used more often. You can even see where they are used. You can directly have the information in here too. You see, of course, how they are defined, and as already said, you can even get some kind of indication if they are doubled or not, if they are duplicates. And here, for example, I do see that there are variables that have the same definition. It's a calendar day, it's a characteristic value, it's user entry, it's a single value, it's ready for input, and it's optional. So everything is the same. So most probably the variable can be basically, these are duplicates, I don't need them. And as I see that only this middle one is used, I can then, for example, decide to clean up the other ones and just continue using the one in the middle. And this kind of easy overview can be retrieved with the Doku Performer. One of the other elements, if you think about projects, is think about what happens if you want to deploy the application or to test it, to transport it, for example, to the testing system. Again, maybe you work with external companies and you have to make sure that the naming convention is kept. What you can do is you can define the naming conventions for every object within the system. And when you define the respective naming conventions, you can run through an analysis. I did that already here. And you can see that in this case, for example, all those elements do not fit the naming convention. And I can adjust this, of course, easily. I can add additional elements. And if I then run through this again, I can identify all the elements that are still not within the naming convention. I can also go with expert rules with more complicated definitions. And what I can also do is I can use this information to check on transport lists. So there is a function which is called resolve transport lists, but it actually does even more than only resolving the objects. So I have selected here now one transport, and you can see that for the respective elements on the transport request, I see the clear name, and I can conduct the verify naming convention as well. I can easily see that something is off. In this case, for example, this data store object, DSO, is fitting, but this one does not fit the respective naming convention. So I could easily go back to the respective team and ask them, for example, to change this and do this on a very early stage rather than very late throughout the project where everything is already under time pressure and you are just happy to get it deployed and don't worry anymore about the naming conventions. What you can also do is you can, of course, before deployment, you can check the respective elements if they are up to date or not. So, for example, in here, you can show elements that have been, that are outdated. So I can, for example, add columns. Again, before you deploy, you maybe want to make sure that the last comment change date is available and that it is also, of course, bigger than the comment, the change date itself. So for example, was it basically adjusted afterwards, after it was commented, or the other way around? Of course, the comments have to be up to date, and therefore the last comment change date should be always after the respective change date. Okay, so this was regarding the transports. So one thing that we have also yet not had a look to is the understanding on what is available on the system. So that was also one important point. So if you have a look again here, what we can see is a matrix of the info provider, in this case, the multi-provider that you already know, that we have been also analyzing in terms of data flow and what kind of queries are available on this multi-provider. And now this gives you the possibility to easily identify, are the elements within the reporting element also used? So here, for example, I would be able to derive, hey, we don't do any kind of reporting on those characteristics. So do we really need those elements, for example, in the info provider? Or if they are changed, maybe, you know, there is no impact on this. I would still suggest, of course, to conduct aware use analysis on those elements, just to be sure that maybe not in ABAP coding the elements are used. But otherwise, you get a pretty good understanding if the elements are relevant or not. But not only this, you can also get the understanding for the functional department how they can use the reports. So especially if you have more than 10 reports, for example, or 20 reports, or sometimes departments have 100 reports, you easily get lost in those reports. Which one can I use for which purpose? And this question you can also answer on a higher level and easily throughout this report. I can, for example, identify with which report I can easily do the analysis by calendar day. Which report gives me the possibility to use calendar day as a free characteristic? And I would be able to see, okay, it's within those two reports. I can also see how the elements are used. Are they used as a free characteristic? Are they used within rows, within filters, within columns? I can even see how the key figures, for example, are used. So in this case, I see that every key figure is also used for some kind of report. But I also see that one report, for example, the first one here, does actually include all the key figures. So most probably I can do all the analysis also in here. I can see also which calculated key figures, restricted key figures, structures, variables, all those reusable elements, I can see how and where and which report they are used as a matrix and easily to understand for any changes that might come. I can also pivot this table. And if I do this, I would be able to easily answer a different kind of questions, right? Again, what kind of report provides the possibility for the, you know, analysis after a certain object? So I can select this respectively, and I see all the relevant queries that would provide the opportunity to do so. So now, again, one thing that I have not yet shown, but I think it's also very helpful and important, is regarding the data lineage. So if we have a look to, again, the multi-provider, we saw already within the transformations what kind of processing is happening. But even then, sometimes also on a higher level, it would be helpful to get this higher level understanding as with the matrix that we have seen. And this is basically possible with the data lineage. So here we can, for one or for also several elements, execute this analysis. And in this case, we can, for example, jump to the summary. We do see how the summary shows us start to end, how the different objects are mapped. So for example, here I see how the calendar day is mapped start to end. So I see that, for example, the calendar day is once retrieved from via an ABAP routine via this DSO. But I also see that it's coming from two different fields. It's coming from from document date and change date. We have seen that also in the other example. And I see immediately from which data sources it is used. And this I can see for the whole data flow, for every object immediately in one view. If this would be not sufficient, if, for example, I need to understand more details how the mappings in between are done, I can also go to the details. So here, for example, I see how the calendar day is mapped throughout all the different phases within the project, within the transformation. I see that it is coming from those DSOs. I see that it is coming from those fields. I see that then it is mapped to this different DSOs. I see that there are two different DSOs, actually three different DSOs, or four, actually, even. Okay. So Then I see from this DSO to which other DSOs it's mapped, so level 3 to level 2. And this helps me to, for example, rebuild something for a migration. Or I can maybe also, for a key user, for a power user within the functional department, get him some more details on how the processing is happening, through which other data info provider it is going, and where the data is processed. So this is very helpful for those kinds of projects. Good. So now we have seen what kind of different supporting possibilities you have. And again, this was also only an excerpt. So there are more functions, as you can see here as well. There are many functions that are available. There are also many details about how you can use the commenting. As said, we do have a lot of information also online, just to one more time mention that. So this page I will also provide after the webinar, and you can easily navigate through. So if you want to remember where it was, you can just click on this. You will then automatically be forwarded to the respective manual and see all the details, how to get there and what kind of results you can expect, etc. Good. So again, maybe you saw that and you found that interesting. So our suggestion is, of course, to find out yourself. So what you can do, right? So we provide 7 days for modeling and translation, and also 60 days for testing otherwise. How you can use this tool to support your projects and migrations and change requests throughout all phases. The existing licenses can also be extended if you have already licenses. And of course, we are always happy to discuss this with you. So if you have the feeling maybe this was too fast or you missed a few aspects, we are always happy to be approached, right? So you can contact us. And then we can conduct, for example, a workshop. We can see through another web session on how we can make that also work for you. So yeah, seeing is believing. As said, this is only a small investment in testing. We just need too much time to do that. The installation is very, very easily possible. Within 20 minutes, you have the whole tool installed and can already start working with it. And the savings, of course, later on is big. So please contact us for individual webinars if you want to get more information about this, or if you want to try to do a 60-day trial run yourself, or, of course, for an on-site workshop with more information and with a more detailed look to your system. We are happy to visit you and go with you through all the relevant aspects and help you to start utilizing the DocuPerformer to the best. Okay, so thanks a lot for your attendance. I wish you a good day and all the best. Bye.